maybe first time brand new human experience to spend my Saturday watching the first hour and a half of Skibidi Toilet.
Right.
And then I don't want to brag or anything, but having sex with a couple of people and then being like, sorry, okay, I can't like hang out after this. I need to watch the rest of Skibidi Toilet. I need to watch an hour and a half more of Skibidi Toilet.
This is the
Toilet.
First time in history that anyone has had a threesome and then had to leave to watch Skibidi Toilet.
You got your intermission for mind-blowing sex is to watch more Skibidi Toilet.
3 a.m. back for more Skibidi.
That's my kink.
Welcome to the Worst of All Possible Worlds, the first and only podcast with a Skibidi Toilet kink. I'm the worst of all possible Joshes.
I'm the worst of all possible AJs.
And I'm the worst of all possible Brians.
And you've already heard from them very briefly, joining us today to talk about the YouTube animated series Skibidi Toilet is the co-host of Radio Free Tote Bag, which is a fantastic relationship advice podcast, which all three of us have been on, by the way.
Yeah.
And I know you've also recently started a sub-series where you talk about Frasier. So yeah, please welcome to the show, Dono.
What's up? I'm Donovan. My pronouns are Skibidi, they, them.
You know what Skibidi got up to last weekend? It was crazy. A threesome and then more Skibidi Toilet.
Well, you said Skibidi, they, them. Is it Skibidi slash they slash them, or is it Skibidi, they slash Skibidi, them?
Ooh. Skibidi, they, up them, them. Is that it?
I think that's something.
You have to say it every time.
Skibidi dop dop zizi.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, I think we can keep working on this. Donovan, you've been on the show a couple times now, and we're so happy to have you back.
So it's cool that the couple times I've been on this show, I mean, at least the last one was for the Colton Burpo episode, which started because I texted Colton Burpo. Because sometimes, as I explained on that episode, like, I got something wrong with my brain, and like, I'll just like really enjoy a really obnoxious word out of context, and I'll just keep saying it. And I think that weekend, I don't know if people actually say this or I made this up, but I started saying on Skibidi.
Right.
Like on Skibidi, I'm stoked to be on this podcast. On Skibidi, I watched all the fucking Skibidi Toilet yesterday. You know, and I was fucking also.
On Skibidi?
On Skibidi.
That's my favorite Stella Adler acting book, On Skibidi.
But so,
I think that's Uta Hagen. Fuck!
I just was saying the goddamn thing because I think it's funny. I had watched what I thought was like all of this, but that was a year ago at this point.
Yeah.
Audrey. Yeah. And it's really expanded out even from a year ago.
Yeah. I didn't know it was still going.
My co-host like subjected me to all of it.
Yeah.
With the Discord, like we streamed it in there with some of our listeners.
Okay.
And I was like, shit, I'm having fun with this. This is dumb as shit.
Yeah.
Like, this is taking me back to like shit I watched in middle school. I'm fucking with this. Hell yeah. It's become a whole thing. I like checked in on it a couple times since then. But mostly just Skibidi's. It's a really fun thing to say.
Yeah.
It's a word that worms its way into your head along with the song, especially in like the first 20 or so episodes of the show.
Well, and that's probably why if you are a teacher and you teach anybody in the age range of like 5 to 14...
Yeah.
Anywhere in there, they're just saying nothing but Skibidi. Skibidi is, in the world of linguistics, it's one of these things where it's becoming a brand new word with multiple meanings, which is kind of interesting. It can mean something's exciting or something's like fucking weird and annoying and cringe, or it can just be a general exclamation depending on how you use it.
I saw that the Skibidi store... they sold backpacks, and I was like, that's really smart.
It is?
Because like, the audience for this thing is all children.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
And the occasional Midwesterner finishing up a threesome.
Yeah. I
Yeah, what fucking weird ass.
The two genders. So there is a thing where, like, that Forbes article that came out about Skibidi Toilet has sort of classified this as Gen Alpha's first cultural
Just say it's
artifact.
For children. It's for children. It's a
yeah,
thing
it's
for
a
kids
show.
Who happen to be kids right now. Ooh, it's a generation. No, yes, because it's for children. We used to just say stuff was for kids.
Yeah.
And now it's like, oh, no, it has
like
to
tricks.
Be part of this fucking... Yeah, exactly. Silly Rabbit, tricks are for boomers. Like, suck my shit.
Goku is the first explicitly millennial superhero.
Right, but the
he's
reason,
Gen X.
But there is a reason why they're referring to it as Gen Alpha, because it is an attempt to say that what Gen Alpha likes is bad. Right?
True.
The framing of that article is that this is nigh incomprehensible brain rot shit that, like, we are ascribing to an entire generation of children because look at what the kids are up to. It's about toilet men.
I like
and
it.
That, over the course of this conversation, I think we will disprove that that's all that's going on with this
show.
Yeah,
children Absolutely. Children have famously never been into toilets. That's never been,
yeah,
like...
Yeah, no. That wasn't Nickelodeon's entire, like, programming strategy for the 90s was like, how many toilets can we put in this, though? Like, how many, like, it's a thing kids like. It's funny. That's where the poop goes.
Yeah, I had a fucking, this is reminding me of two things. I didn't finish my thought before. I'm kind of hungover from watching all of that fucking Skibidi Toilet
and having all that sex.
I shouldn't have said that. I'm like, I was telling a couple friends this. I was like, yeah, I'm watching all of Skibidi Toilet to go on a podcast to talk about Skibidi Toilet, and I had this moment of just like, how the fuck did I get here? I'm 32 years old. What am I doing?
I imagine you rolling out of bed, just taking a shot of Malort and going, let's fucking do this,
let's
right?
Let's go. Hey, you wanna stick around and cuddle and watch Skibidi Toilet? No, so over the summer, it was brought back into my consciousness though, and like firsthand saw, okay, the kids love Skibidi. I was at a wedding. I was at my friend's wedding that I was officiating for the first time. That was very cool.
Well,
and so I'm riding that high, and I'm in the bathroom after it, and it's one with just like a stall and a urinal. It's like a big outdoor venue. Mm-hmm. So I'm in there taking a little shit, like a post-wedding shit, and sitting in the stall, and I hear two fucking kids walk in, and they say Skibidi probably a dozen times in 1 minute. And I had this moment sitting on the toilet, which was very fitting of like, oh, it's fucking real, dude. The kids are just, and there was no rhyme or reason to it. Like, it just sounded like they just kept saying it over and over again. And I was like, the kids are all right, man. That's beautiful.
Brian, AJ, what was your exposure to Skibidi Toilet up until now?
Like most things that are in the vertical video format, I usually just see someone mad about it on Twitter.
Sure.
You know, I don't have a TikTok account. I had one that I infrequently used, and then TikTok just deleted it for no reason. I ignore shorts on YouTube and things like that. And so usually I just see someone who's probably about my age being like, this is what kids are looking at on fucking on the video platforms.
Right.
This is my Adam Carolla impression for some reason.
It's really
this
good.
Is what the kids are watching.
It's
Drew
really
Pinsky.
Haunting. It's weird you have that trampoline behind you with just those women
all
perpetually
those juggies.
Bouncing.
Yeah. They're very nice ladies.
I went on to do a quick search for Focus on the Family Skibidi Toilet because I was sure I would be able to find
so good.
Some piece of like pearl clutching about it, and it did not disappoint. I found an image on their Facebook page, and it says, you may have heard your kids talking about Skibidi Toilet. Here's why you as a parent should pay attention.
For my part, I hadn't really, I heard the name Skibidi Toilet around, but like, I think I'd seen like one image of it, and it just gave that sort of Garry's Mod vibe about it.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
that was an entire scene that I missed entirely and holds no nostalgic value for me.
Yeah,
so
yeah, same.
Yeah, so I just kind of, I bounced off it because I was just like, there comes a point in your life where you're like, this is not for me. This is for
me,
the next generation to absorb. And it's great that they have that, but it's just, It's not incomprehensible to me, especially now having watched the whole thing. Like, I get why kids would be into this, but it lights up no parts of my brain in a way that, like, I feel it lights up so many kids around the world.
Yeah, so initially, and mine, unfortunately.
Yeah. Initially on Twitter, I had seen the video of the DJ toilet.
Oh, yeah.
Which is like number four or five or something. It's before, you know, the war starts.
Yeah, one of the fun ones. Pre-war. I like to refer to that one as one of the fun ones.
And it's a different spin on the song. So in my head, that was the Skibidi song for a long time. And then the next one I saw was like of the cameramen the first time they like beat back the Skibidis with the speaker men, and you hear Tears for Fears as well. So for a long time, those were my only exposures to Skibidi Toilet, were those two things. And they're so nonsensical, especially out of context, so much as like context actually gives you anything, that people are just like, This is killing children.
Yes. This is murdering them dead. Murder. And it's not. I want to be very clear. I'm going to say some very unkind things over the course of this episode. Deeply, deeply unkind things. Yeah. But I don't want that to ever be construed as, I think it's bad that this thing exists. I think that it's great that it brings joy to a lot of kids. But I think that what it does is, after it starts moving on to grander ambitions outside of just being YouTube slop. Poop and slop, I think it really falls flat on its face. And I'm going to, and because it has those ambitions to be this grander narrative, I'm going to be judging it on those ambitions. Because the other thing is that, like, this is not a finished series. Literally, last night, the fourth part of the 77th episode of Skibidi
Toilet. That's just a separate episode at that
which
point.
Which is just a separate episode. Part four. I mean, come on. So this thing is still in progress. And the amount of, like, leaps and bounds that they've made just in terms of the visuals over the course of it, and how, and as the series has gone on, like, the bigger and grander ideas that they started incorporating into it, they could get better over time. So what I'm saying here is that I am just judging this first part, and if in 20 years you revisit this episode, maybe it is like the uber text of all society, and we are all living in Skibidi's world. Just know that this is the initial impression that I had, and maybe my advice will be taken and they'll listen to me, this series that has made $150 million.
Well, thank you for that closing monologue, AJ.
Yeah. Well, look.
I want this to be over. I don't want to talk about Skibidi Toilet.
This is, of course, the worst of all possible worlds, which means that we have to go into way too much detail about, you know, every piece of how this thing came to be made. So over the course of this episode, we're going to talk about some of those formative influences that were formative influences, I think, in some of our lives as well. And then moving on to really recapping the whole series. And then by the end, we're going to find out that some surprising forces with quite a bit of fucking money have been making a pretty serious creative impact on the direction of this show.
So just a warning for everyone, and this comes from Focus on the Family, as we mentioned earlier.
Yeah. From Plugged In,
Plugged In's own Kennedy Unthank.
What? On what?
I'm sorry, what?
What's the name?
Kennedy Unthank. I know what holiday he's not celebrating.
I imagine he's the kind of guy who goes for a handshake and then goes, ooh, too slow, and puts it back through his hand.
Well, anyway, normal man, Kennedy Unthank.
Yeah.
His conclusion on Skibidi Toilet was, there's a high chance that your grade school child's heard something related to, quote, Skibidi, end quote, at some point. Mm. While the word itself may be harmless nonsense, it may motivate them to search out the popular YouTube series for themselves.
Mm.
And da fuck booms, toilet laded battleground.
Laded?
Laded.
Laded.
Huh. Likely won't be the place you want your child visiting.
So, quick show of hands here. Were any of you other?
No, like, we have to say it out loud. It's a podcast.
Well, you can raise your hand verbally by saying present.
I'm raising my hand.
Yeah, who was into Machinima back in the day? Was it just me?
Hand.
Okay.
Me kind of. You know, like I've talked about, I had dial-up internet until I was like a junior in high school, and then I was too much of an adult to care about this stuff. I did, however, have G4 TV. and G4 had the show Cinematech.
Right.
Which did all kinds of things. A lot of times it was just like trailers. Sometimes there was even like speed runs. Those were fun to watch for the first time in my life.
Sure.
Not realizing that that was going to become like the fourth major pillar of American popular culture.
Yeah.
You know, and this is an old show. This was stuff that was, you know, predates YouTube and everything. They were collecting machinima from all around the web. QuickTime movies of, you know, My Brand and whatever else.
I was not into machinima, but I think I was into something that was sort of machinima adjacent, which was the abridged series on YouTube. So like Yu-Gi-Oh! And Dragon Ball Z, which, you know, it takes a familiar property and then redubs over it, basically. So like I knew about Red versus Blue, but I had never really watched it in earnest necessarily. But I was sort of vaguely aware of it.
So
it was hard not to be.
Just to define what machinima is, basically it is animated storytelling using video game engines and assets.
Yes.
So you are creating a story where the protagonist is, I don't know, Doom Guy or whatever, right? This kind of evolved out of the demo scene. Programmers would use these video game assets and engines to build these really, really elaborate demonstrations that would push the technical limitations of the various platforms. And it was because they were able to do these really cool things that they then started thinking more broadly about, like, okay, what sorts of stories can we tell using video games? And people started using Quake to do a lot of this. Mm-hmm. There was like a fucking 4-hour long machinima made in Quake that was sort of like the first big example of like a fully attempt at telling a full story.
They do often get very long.
Yes.
I love this shit.
Yeah.
I'm very into DIY art and what comes out of situations where you have technical limitations on what you can make. And the demo scene in machinima that comes out of it is really cool to me because it's that intersection of like computer internet culture is a thing growing, but it comes out of the technical limitation of not being able to transfer huge fucking video files.
Right.
Yeah.
If you have the engine for a game and your animation is basically just a series of movements or maybe audio for the characters, it's much easier to do that file transfer.
The demo scene, a big piece of it was how small of a file can you make that sort of leaves the biggest impression?
Yeah.
Because this was before the age of compressed video and that sort of thing, and before the age of widespread broadband. And so, like you said, Donald, like these technical tools, people were still figuring out how to use them to the fullest effect. And it was, it would require quite a bit of like technical wizardry to pull this stuff off.
And for a bunch of nerdy guys who like want to make a movie, I mean, you have to think about like when my dad was in high school, he made a parody of Star Trek with his friends. His buddy Lee as Spock, and like, you know, they built sets, they lit off a lot of fireworks, they blew a lot of shit up, and it's very fun. You know, they had to come up with costumes. But, you know, it's all shot on Super 8 film. It all costs money. And you get to the late 90s and then into the 2000s, you can make something based on that property that you like that's just in the property itself. You like Halo a bunch and you want to have Master Chief talk about jacking off or whatever, or being a pacifist and everybody mishears him and just calls him a pussy fast.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can just do that using all this stuff in the game without spending any money. Also, you don't need friends or to be honest, you know, and you don't need local friends. You could have a bunch of friends you're making this stuff with and then have them, you know, through correspondence, send their voice samples in and record their shit.
I love this. Like, I think just a lot of very interesting and not even necessarily extremely good. I just have an appreciation for things like that. That as one person, I want to make a thing and I'm figuring out how to do that with these new tools at my disposal that gives it its own distinct aesthetic and all of these things. I just, I don't know. I got a soft spot for all of this stuff, having grown up with it, but also just the DIY art generally.
Did you have any favorites? I mean, we were sort of mentioning Red versus Blue, which was built in the Halo engine. Was that one of your favorites, or were there others that you liked?
I never had like Xbox. I never had I would like play those at friends. Inside a friend who was really into Red versus Blue. I think this is when I was in middle school.
Yeah.
And I dug the stuff I really liked. I played Battlefield 1942 and Battlefield 2. Those were like my first.
Sure.
Big like online games I played. There was a series of BF2 machinima type things that I remember very little of,
yeah,
to be honest. But I remember having a couple of them downloaded on my PSP. And like, okay, I brought it to school and was like, we're going to watch this fucking shit on my 1 gigabyte memory card, and like feeling cool.
Put
as
that
fuck
on a
this.
Memory stick duo, yes, featuring Magic Gate technology.
Exactly.
Well, and like Red versus Blue, I had friends who had that shit again because we all had fucking dial up because we lived in Gallup, New Mexico. They had Red versus Blue on DVD. You know, like you could buy it at the GameStop on
that's
DVD.
Right. I
you
remember
could probably
seeing it,
also
yeah,
get it for PSP on the Universal Media Disc.
Yeah.
God, I gotta wonder what the licensing was like for that. Do you know what I mean?
I don't think, no, I think they didn't give any thought to it. And that's gonna be a big theme going forward because Skibidi Toilet, there's just a lot of stuff in there. You're right. But you're taking stuff that other people have made and just using it.
By AJ, when you say what they were thinking relicensing, you mean Bungie and Microsoft, right?
Yes, like, that's what I mean.
Their
yeah,
assets, yeah. Say yeah, more yeah, about that.
My buddies and I in college did like a Borderlands like web series thing, and we got cease and desisted right, pretty yeah, immediately.
By Gearbox, right?
By Gearbox, ooh, because one of the reward tiers for like, you know, you give us a certain money, we would make a modded Nerf gun in the style of Borderlands. And they're like, well, that's technically Borderlands merch.
Right.
So we're shutting this whole thing
off,
down.
I mean,
to be fair, sure. Like that, we were charging money and giving something in exchange yeah, for it. So sure. But like, how did Red versus Blue, how were they right, able to right, do this on such a massive scale?
Well, and it's a big open question because this also goes back to Star Trek, actually. Sorry, I'm bringing it back to Star Trek, guys. I'm bringing it back to my dad. Bring it back to a future dentist and a future jet pilot and a future microwave engineer making some stupid shit on my dad's backyard.
Sounds yeah, like Trekkies, yeah.
One of their aliens was just someone's brother wearing a wig on his face.
Yes!
but backwards, right? So like a cousin it situation?
So like a large tribble, basically?
Yeah, sort of. Yeah, yeah. You could do, yes. Yeah, that, I like that. And because you couldn't record sound on most Super 8, the whole thing was dubbed later with them watching the film in front of them. And so the alien is just going...
Oh hell yeah, dude.
So my dad and his friends, they never brought that film to conventions. That was just sort of a thing that they all made together along with my grandma, who sometimes held the camera. But they didn't sell it, they didn't bring it to conventions, but they could have, because there are a lot of very old Star Trek fan films. This is still a tradition. This is something that Paramount has kind of been a little bit, has a lot more friction with lately, but they were early on just going to be like, yeah, you can call it Star Trek. There are parameters that you need to follow, but like, you want to put on the uniforms, you want to make like a Lost Adventure of Captain Kirk, and you built the whole set in your garage, go right ahead. With video right, games rolling around, there is the copyright, and especially Digital Millennium Copyright Act.
Right.
There's the question of like, if you developed a video game and someone wants to make money making content based on that video game, you can stop them whenever you want.
Absolutely.
Right? Right. The question is whether you have the mandate of heaven. The question right, is, are people yeah, going to get mad at you and stop buying your shit if you do that?
Well, in video games, generally speaking, it is a culture of freer attribution mm-hmm, than is the case right, in other media. I mean,
sure,
my personal favorite machinima, and I think I might have talked about it on the show before, is the Deus Ex Recut.
Your appointment to FEMA should be finalized within the week. I have already discussed the matter with the senator.
I take it he was agreeable?
Oh, yes.
Has he been infected?
Oh, yes.
I hope you're not underestimating the problem.
Yes. When I mentioned that we could put him on the priority list for the Ambrosia vaccine, he was desperate.
This plague, the rioting is intensifying to the point where we may not be able to contain it.
Why contain it? It's cool.
So this is a template for a lot of machinima where
yeah,
you're taking, because just visually what's going on here is it's literally just the opening cutscene from Deus Ex with those character models. It's the opening dialogue, but it's been remixed in a way to make it sillier and more absurd. There's stuff that tries for more like dramatic heft, but for the most part, it's this kind of shitpost that dictates the genre.
So many possible Hey there, you are listening to a preview of a premium episode of The Worst of All Possible Worlds. If you'd like to listen to the rest of this, head on over to our Patreon. That's patreon.com/worstofall, and you can listen to not only the rest of this episode, but our entire backlog of premium episodes, bonus episodes, and if you subscribe at the $10 tier, you will get an extra episode of the podcast every single month. Again, that is patreon.com/worstofall. Hope to see you there.